And I want you to know that if you come here, I'm going to make it worth your time. But also, practical knowledge for me is an important thing. You should be able to get something from this class you can use in your daily life. There's nobody here that don't got an attitude. Somebody got an attitude. Got a good attitude, a bad attitude, an attitude pro this or con that. We all have attitudes. Attitudes, really, beliefs. Could be about people, could be about objects, could be about ideas, situations. They are evaluative in nature. So not all beliefs are evaluative in nature, right? But in a way, you think about it, they kind of are if they're an attitude. So I can have an attitude that today's a nice day in terms of the temperature, and I like rain. People go, no, that's wrong. But it really is just my attitude that determines it. It's my belief. I evaluate whether rain is a good thing or a bad thing. Evaluating it is what makes it an attitude. It has a valence. Usually it's towards pro or towards con. Based on experience, guides our behaviors, but not all our behaviors. A lot of people think that people will do things that are consistent with the attitudes and beliefs that they hold, but the social psych chapter, I hope, will show you that's not always the case, and sometimes it's clearly not the case. People sometimes act in ways very different than you would predict if you knew their attitudes. So they have affective, meaning emotional, they have behavioral and cognitive or thinking components, these attitudes. And we change attitudes during our lives, and we try to change other people's attitudes. So if you've ever had a political discussion, for example, or a religious discussion, or even a discussion about where you want to eat dinner tonight, or what movie you want to see, you have two people with different attitudes or similar attitudes. When they're similar, it's pretty easy to resolve the discussions or the decisions. When they're really different, though, you run into conflict, and people would like others to change their attitudes. We'll see that people like consistency, and they like other people who are consistent with them. They like people who are like themselves. Attitude change, the little triangle means change, occurs via two routes. The central route is for attitudes that are strongly held and are important to somebody. So the only way you're going to change that attitude is with an important message. You're not going to change it willy-nilly, right? You got to have some kind of convincing argument processed with close attention, and it's got to seem logical, and as we'll see, it needs to come from a credible source. Otherwise, you just discount it right off the bat. So if you want to change somebody's deeply held opinion, you need to have somebody who has an important, logical, convincing message and delivers it with authority that is deemed credible. Otherwise, the person won't even pay attention to it, right? They'll just dismiss it right off the bat. But there's a lot of attitudes we hold that really aren't that strong, and they really aren't that important, and they can be changed through what's called the peripheral route. And the kinds of things that we see changed in the peripheral route are more maybe people's preferences or whims, but not something that they hold deeply. Now, the message is not that important. It might be given by an attractive or expert source, even though they don't have to be expert, because it's somewhat superficial. You'll oftentimes see people that look like doctors pitching things on TV, and underneath it, it says, not an actual doctor, right? They're just wearing a lab coat. And that's enough. That's enough. They don't actually have to have credibility. They just have to appear credible, roughly speaking. It doesn't have to receive a lot of attention, but it changes attitude, oftentimes through repetition. Most advertisements are played again and again and again and again in the same time slots, hitting the same audience again and again and again, and people might change their opinions of things without even really realizing they're doing it. My favorite example is toothpaste. Are you really devoted to your toothpaste? Is it the only toothpaste you'll ever use? You won't use another toothpaste, and you won't hear anybody slam your toothpaste? Right? Or is it just toothpaste? Go to Walmart or any other big box store and go to the toothpaste aisle. Normally you just go get your brand, right? And you don't really step back, but step back and look at how many pastes there are for your teeth. There's tons and tons and tons of pastes for teeth, but they only really have one active ingredient if we're talking about preventing tooth decay, and they all have it. Right? So what would make you change toothpaste brands? My guess is it wouldn't take much. Maybe a sale or a friend saying, try this, or somebody who's pitching it on TV that you're like, oh, my favorite actor uses this brand, so why not? Why not indeed? Because it's not that important. But if you want to change somebody's deeply held conviction, that's not going to be easy to do. So factors in changing attitudes, you'll want to know these. One I've already alluded to is the communicator. Who is delivering the message? Is the communicator credible? Does he have an agenda? Or does she have honesty? Or does he have something to gain? Or is he or she attractive? Are they well known? Are they popular? Are they expert? Are they mature looking? Looking mature swings elections. They found that candidates who are deemed to look mature get more votes irrespective of their platforms. People just want to believe that somebody's mature. You think about the upcoming elections we have. They always happen in every year or 2 years or 4 years. How deeply have you processed the actual candidates? Right? You think about the depth of your convictions, and people are like, yes, I believe this. But then you look at their actions when they go to the polls. So if y'all are going to vote in the SGA elections, who are you voting for? Do you even know who these people are? And then oftentimes we go to the polls maybe to vote for a big ticket item, like who we send to the United States Senate or House of Representatives or executive branch. But then we have all these local people we vote for too. And many times people don't even know who they are, but it doesn't stop them from voting based on the label they see attached to it, or whether the name sounds good or interesting, or whether they've seen them in person. So one person has come up to me from the local election, and I now know that person. I'm more likely to vote for them simply because what? I don't know their opponent. I know them. Not well, but I've met them. So those things sway us because, you see, he looked like a credible guy to me. He seemed pretty honest. I know he wants to gain office, but it's not a high office. And I think, well, this is going to be more work for him than anything he could ever get out of it, right? He's a good-looking guy. I don't know him. He wasn't popular. But I actually quizzed him on a few things that I thought people should know if elected for office, and he had great answers. And he was a former Eagle Scout. And I thought, you know, that conveys information, doesn't it? Because it tells me he's got a certain maturity. Those are elements that we don't consciously process, but frequently unconsciously take note of, and it sways us. The communication itself, is it logical? Is it clear? Is it convincing? Because if you paid attention to any political discussion, for example, what you'll see is both sides being left or right, and this being America, I love all sides, right? You have a right to think whatever you want to think. But what you'll see is they often take very deep, different interpretations of the same occurrences. Meaning, the facts are seen differently, right? They're not different facts, theoretically. They're different interpretations. And so, if I have an already deeply held opinion, maybe it's a worldview, maybe it's a political persuasion, that's actually going to influence how I interpret facts and reality. To change me from that position, not that it's right or wrong to be in a position, don't get me wrong, but if you want to change somebody that's already got a deeply held, then you better be logical, clear, and convincing. Is there a fear appeal? We use fear appeals all the time, right? We have changed dramatically as a country, and what we assume to be basic privacy rights and freedom rights since 9/11, right? Because people saw a terrible, terrible occurrence happen fairly randomly, right? Nobody saw it coming. And there's a fear that it could happen again. So we don't want it to happen again, and we take all manner of measures to prevent it. But how many measures are too far or unnecessary? It's hard to know. But if you have that fear, it's hard to process things in a totally objective fashion because you're dealing with an emotional aspect that doesn't necessarily lend itself to logic. There's not a right answer. All you can say is whether something did or didn't happen afterwards. So you can say everything we've done has worked. Or maybe it's only been some subset of what we've done has worked. Or if it happens, God forbid, and all the stuff we thought was working didn't work, then we would only know then. But we make big decisions about our lives, oftentimes not based on logic, but based on emotion, the way we feel. And is it heard repeatedly? Is it heard repeatedly? Is it heard repeatedly? Is it heard repeatedly? In political advertisements, a lot of times when you do the fact checking, people will say, that's clearly not true, right? But they say it again and again and again and again and again, and a lie told frequently enough oftentimes is perceived as truth. How can they get away with it? Well, it's not a bold-faced lie, but it's an interpretation of facts that seems really negative and said again and again and again. It becomes convincing, even if it's not accurate. So the communication, the medium matters. The medium changes. There used to be only one real medium, and that was face-to-face interaction. It was only after the advent of the printing press, right, that we started even getting literacy in society. And that was a long time coming. In the 20th century, most Americans could read, but we didn't have technologies in the early 20th century that were widespread. Radios, when they first came about, were luxury items. Televisions were luxury items. Now radios and TVs are normal. They come as standard units in cars. Cars are normal, right? The face-to-face communication that this young man came and was trying to meet people in the neighborhood is unusual. But that has a compelling element to it, because I can turn off a radio, I can tune out a TV, but when I have that face-to-face interaction, it's harder to ignore that, because now I have the power of the in-person process, face-to-face. Print, do people even get magazines and newspapers anymore? Of course they do, but not nearly as much as they used to. Speech, is that one that's going to be televised? What about YouTube? What about internet? Facebook is a good medium for some target audiences, but a poor medium for you in general, right? The 18-year-old crowd is easier to reach on a silly app than it is to reach on Facebook or MySpace, things that change really, really quickly. Mediums used to be somewhat static. There was in person, you could go see a speech, right? Or you could watch it on TV and watch it on radio, but now, or hear it on the radio or read it in the paper. Now we've got this electronic format where we can email people and we can text people and we can have them watch videos and all manner of things. Which one's most effective? It depends on your target audience and your use of the medium. Finally, we got the audience. Who are you talking to? Right? If you've got an audience that's open to change, then you have the possibility of changing their attitudes. If you've got an audience that's entrenched, a mob does not change its opinion very easily, right? But not uncivilized, just a group of people. If you have an audience of people who've already got a committed position, that might be what brought them together as an audience. To walk in with the opposite opinion and expect them to be open to the notion that you have to convey is not a very logical or realistic thing to do. It's interesting. I watched a seminar given by a physicist on the moon landing myth, right? Where people believe that the moon landing was a fake. Some people hold that belief deeply and they say, I can prove it with all these elements. Well, his entire talk was showing that those elements really aren't correct, that there was a good physical explanation for the shadow going this way, or there being a ripple in the flag, or et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, all the things that are used. He said, but what's amazing to me is after I go through all the science of how everything that's used as evidence to prove that it was a hoax, I've dispelled all of that. At the end of my talk, I still have people come up to me and think it's a hoax. That element of the audience was not open to change. They had decided it was a hoax, and no amount of evidence to the contrary is going to be sufficient for them to believe necessarily. But if other people are like, I'm kind of on the fence, I don't know, was it a hoax, was it real? Those people might be open to hearing it. as evidence, potentially.